Finally, can you hear me? Maybe. If you guys can hear me, put a number one in the chat so I know I'm not speaking to myself. All right. Thank God. Every time I pressed go live, it was saying it was an error. Try again in a few minutes. And that's how long those minutes lasted. So I apologize, guys, for that. And Mama Bear and Paige are going to be joining us. And let me see here. Hello, Mama Bear. Hello, Paige. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Good Lord, Jesus. That was an ordeal. Wow.
Finally working.
What a pain in the butt. No, every time I pressed go, it was like, nope, error. Try again in a few minutes. So I'm going to re-pull up my stuff here that I had open because I didn't know what was going on with that.
So strange. Never seen it before.
Yeah, I've never seen it do all that kind of crap. So, and let me
just pretend that didn't happen. Rewind.
Yes. Erase. Well, I hope the chat all got to yap with each other a little bit and stuff there as we do this. And let's see. I need to go and pull these that we were going to go over with everybody. And make sure I've got them right here. And I'll probably pull those up from here. Well, I hope you guys are doing well. We apologize for the crap. I've never had an issue just clicking to go live on StreamYard. So I apologize for that. But we are going to be going over a bunch of different things today. And Mama Bear, are you there? Maybe. Is she on mute?
Maybe you should go out and come back in if you can hear us.
Yeah, I don't know if she can or not, but she looks like she's on mute.
Multitude of errors so far.
Yeah, so we're going to go over a bunch of different documents and stuff for you guys. I just got to re-pull my stuff up that I had here in addition to that. So there we go.
Okay, she's backstage again, just so you know.
Paige, can you go ahead and pull back up the, it's not letting me do it. Can you pull up the document for the defense response to the contempt hearing?
Do you have it, Mama Bear? Can you hear me? I don't think she can hear us still talk right. Let me see.
See, it's not letting me open it. But I think it's because of all the other stuff I opened first. Let me check.
On the device,
I'm
using, I don't think it's going to let me go into that unless I come out of StreamYard. On the browser I'm on.
Let me see what this one is. Okay, here's the one. And well, we're going to be going over the changes to the story that the defense team has had I'm going to show you Elaine. I know a lot of people are like, wait a minute, there's been a lot of. I found it, Paige. Don't worry about it.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Great. Well, I should have went on a different browser. It won't let me go back
Six.
unless I exit. God damn.
And I hope that's the right one I wanted. We're also going to show that a lot of people are asking, okay, why can we see that stuff is being filed by the defense and yet we can't see the documents? And I've got the info to show you about all of that. So, again, sorry, we basically had to do a reset up here. So let me go back.
Try and readjust everything.
Yeah, now I don't know if it'll let me pull it up like I want to or not.
Still giving you
Okay.
issues now.
There we go. Nope. Okay. Now I can click back out of this. That's what will
Okay.
slow me down. I'm
Cool.
so sorry, guys. Never, what a pain in the ass.
Technology.
Yes. All right. So, as you know from the slide of the show and stuff like that, we learned that the defense team has been changing the story as it re in regards to Westerman stealing the leaked photos and that it was all about him who did all of this kind of thing.
Yeah.
I thought, I'm like, okay, what's the best way to kind of show this? And I really think the statement from the prosecutor and that is the best way to kind of show that to you. So, we're going to go over that really quick. And because I just think it's worth hearing.
Yeah,
So,
for sure.
all right. I'm going to just go to entire screen so I don't have to mess with any of that and share audio, all audio too. Yes, I know. Oh, that's freaky. Okay.
Trippy.
Yeah, very much so. All right, go back to the damn documents that I want to show you guys. All right, I'll just do it this way. Stop opening pages and downloads. I already opened this, but I don't can't make it tell me where it is. All right, let me pull this up. Sorry, I know I'd be pissed at myself too. I'm pissed at me right now. All right, so this is
Honestly, I
the
think you're great. You're graceful. So,
state's memorandum in support of the contempt conduct. I want to point out, so we are less than 5 weeks away from the beginning of the trial date, meaning from yesterday, right? Or from Monday. And so, because of that reason, the timing of when these came out, the judge has to respond within 30 days of the contempt hearing. That puts it basically the week before the trial. So she's going to make a judgment if they're found in contempt prior to this. And all this information. So in this document from McLeland's filing, he is talking about that the prosecuting attorney himself files in the finding fact and conclusions of law for the hearing of the information of contemptuous conduct filed by the state, A hearing was held on the contemptuous information on March 18th, 2024. Evidence was heard and concluded. The court accepted the exhibits into evidence and took its decision under advisement pending memorandum filed by each side. The state now files this memorandum in support of the information to the contemptuous conduct. Okay, so one, please note, people don't have the full details of everything that was presented, like the stuff that they talk about. We only know based on the memorandums that were filed. So the exhibits that the state put into the evidence support the contemptuous include on the part of Brad Rosie and Andrew Baldwin outlined in the state's information for contemptuous conduct. The deception to the court began in November of 2022 when both Brad Rosie and Andrew Baldwin told the court that a gag order was not necessary because they had no intentions to talk to the media about the case. Within a week, both Bad Rosie.
I do that all the time.
Was that unconscious? That was subconscious, right?
At least you didn't say Rosie again.
Yes, that's true. Now I'll do it that you brought it up. Within a week, Brad Rosie and Andrew Baldwin published a press release to media outlets. Brad Rosie testified at the contempt proceedings that this was to curry favor to the client. It is clear that the press release was to carry favor with the public. Although it was not a violation of any gag order because she hadn't put it in effect yet, because they had just met on the 22nd. So that was their very first time of meeting about anything. The future contempts shown to the court by showing blatant dishonesty. So the next set of indiscretions was an email from Andrew Baldwin to Brandon Woodhouse. So Brandon Woodhouse was a man who sued the courts, and he won in his lawsuit and stood the courts. He was in that jail. He came out on his own YouTube channel trying to say, hey, you know, this got sent to him. Some people believed him, some people didn't. And he kind of wasn't really putting stuff up about that, but you know, it's later found out that it was for real. So this email was a violation of the gag order. The email released information from discovery to a member of the public. That member of the public then further disseminated information protected by the gag order by putting it on the internet for the world to consume. While content in the email may not be egregious to the court, the fact that Andrew Baldwin and Brad Rosie and their error from the court until it was found by the state is egregious, showing yet another example of the defense deceiving the court. Remember, like Brad Rosie seemed surprised when he was in the chambers about the stuff with Woodhouse. Like he didn't learn about all that kind of stuff and really know about it. Really wasn't really told to him about what happened with that. Mm-hmm. So there's kind of a pattern with that. Finally, the defense intentionally and knowingly leaked information to the public in the form of crime scene photos and other discovery protected by the gag order and the protective order. So we want to point out, and you guys jump in at whatever time, that those are two separate orders. So the gag order is shut everybody up. Law enforcement, the attorneys, families, witnesses, anybody dealing with the case, you've got to keep quiet. That's it. The protective order is standard professional practice that as an attorney, you don't release discovery materials. I mean, crime scene photos aren't supposed to get out before a trial has even happened. So The state admitted screenshots of text messages between Mark Cohen and Robert Fortson, neither of which are involved in the case in any way, nor are they employees or team members of anyone involved in the case. So, Paige, you want to kind of just give a little quick scenario of who Mark is and who Robert was?
Yeah, so Robert was the person that was sent those images, I believe, and also Mark Cohen. And I believe one of those is the gentleman who committed suicide as well later on.
Right. Robert Fortson committed suicide.
Yeah. Yes.
And Robert Fortson was from Fishers, and he has a background of of being family living in Kokomo, but they originally from Delphi.
Right.
Sorry, you know my dog.
He's going off again. He's got something to say.
Oh, you're talking on the TV. Let me do this. Sorry about that. All right.
Yeah.
So they talk about how they're not employees. While these screenshots are voluminous, they paint a clear picture that Robert Fortson speaks about information that is only privy to the defense. Robert Fortson talks about it within days of the defense receiving discovery from the state. Robert Fortson has copies of the crime scene photos. He knows the defense is working on certain aspects of the case, and he knows about the oral interviews with Professor Turco. So Professor Turco is the Purdue professor that they, at the very beginning of the case, when they found the girls, he basically was taken the info of the scene and asked if what he thought. Did he think this could be ritualistic? You know, those types of things. So it was taken very much at the beginning. Yes. And as you guys have known from watching the shows and even post, but let me remind everybody, please watch Community Post, because I do a lot of updates of court documents and what's going on in there. But he has already said that, one, the defense has never talked to him. Okay. I mean, they keep using him like that. Hey, your guy is saying it's this way, but they never spoke to him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that they were taking him out of context.
Right. And if you really thought that that is what his statement said and law enforcement disregarded that or falsified what he said, why wouldn't you want to talk to him directly to get a clear picture of what he said? It makes no sense.
Right. And that was from a document that the prosecutor even asked that same thing. It's like they haven't even spoke to him.
Yeah, stupid.
Yeah, that was pretty much a shocker, because I thought for sure they were maybe talking to him and it was like this whole different thing.
Come on, at least do your homework a little bit, God's sake.
But if people don't think that, they think, oh, they're hearing it from a professor who's a professional. Okay, so you got the messages between, I don't want to miss any piece of this, because this is probably the best information that's in this, as they tracked it. So let me go back. All right. Worked in certain aspects of the case, and he knows about the oral interview with Professor Turco 3 days after the recorded statement is turned over to the defense. So the defense states that Mitch Westerman, former employee of Baldwin. Sorry, I don't want to assume everybody knows who these people are. And I know some of you don't. If some of you are new to the case and whatever, we don't want to assume.
It's also easy to mix them up. There's so many different names of people.
Right. And I don't want to, I apologize for, you know, people who have been there from the very beginning and are rehearing all these names, but I want to be courteous of people who don't know who they are. So Mitch Westerman, a former employee, but not an attorney, in with Baldwin, co-worker friend who is from Westfield, Indiana. So the defense states that Mitch Westerman broke into their office and stole the pictures and then released them to Robert Fortson. Okay, I will say this, the term broke in.
Yeah.
I don't know about that, but I mean, they definitely were saying that Westerman came into the office. Baldwin wasn't in the conference room. The conference room is where they had all the evidence and everything spread out. And they stated that Baldwin must have been in his own office or taking a call or something. They had no idea. And that Westerman went into this conference room, unbeknownst to him, took photos of the photos. And that is why he's being charged in Johnson County, Indiana, where the office is located, for stealing, mm-hmm. basically for taking these things, because that's what they were saying he did. So it is clear from the messages between Mark Cohen, who is a guy from Texas, right? Yeah. He's the guy from Texas.
Right.
Who got the photos and stuff from Robert Fortson, who's from Fishers, Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
And that Robert Fortson received the crime scene photos and other discovery from Mitch Westerman. So we've got Mitch gave it to Westerman, friends of Baldwin, used to work with them in the same office, gives them to Robert Fortson. Robert Fortson gets them to Mark Cohen, Texas. So it also cleared that Mitch Westerman was feeding Robert Fortson several other pieces of discovery all the way up until October 2nd of 2023. The leak was reoccurring, and that's a big deal. There, it wasn't just, oops, these pictures there and they got out. It was that they knew stuff constantly.
Mm-hmm. Just so you know, I'm pretty sure Mama Bear is waiting in the...
Oh, I thought I popped her up already.
Oh, no. No, you didn't.
Hold on.
Not a problem.
I saw her in there. Let's see. Oh.
Oh, I'm sorry. Damn it.
Okay, now let me go back.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, Lord. I'm sorry, guys. Jeez, oh, Pete. And then we just lost the document, too.
Rewind. That didn't happen.
Sorry, guys in chat. You can blame me. As usual.
Oh, don't be gone. Son of a bitch. Oh, wait. There it is. Okay. It was an effort by the defense to put the information... I don't want to miss that line. Okay, so we had the October 20th. The leak was reoccurring. It is also clear that from the text messages from Mark Cohen and Robert Fortson, that the strategy to leaking the information is to gauge the public's opinion of the leaked information. It was an effort by the defense to put the information out to the public to gauge their response to the defense's theory of the case. This would allow the defense to change the strategy if the public response wasn't one that they thought was beneficial. I mean, so when you guys hear that, I mean, constant communication back and forth, Baldwin is directly contacting Westerman. Westerman's getting it out to Fortson. You know, Fortson has a Delphi connection, so that's interesting all by itself. but don't know what that means, if anything. And then you've got it going to Mark. Okay. And I'm not going to go deep into all the other people who don't give a shit about the families and keep showing it. Because that shit is still going on. And if you're new to the case or don't follow the stuff, there are people, there are YouTubers from other countries who are showing the crime scene still.
Yeah, so they're not people. Just so we're clear on that.
Yeah, it is horrific. And that they shared it back to the family is what's horrific.
Yep.
You know, that the fear that they had about the forever that their children's crime scene would be out on the internet was realized because there are people who now have it who are using that to get views and to talk all kinds of shit.
Yeah.
And don't give a shit that that it's part of a case and that it shouldn't have been released and it's illegal to have. And it is CSAM because it is a child who is under age 18. It is a crime scene. So I can't.
And it doesn't matter if those images that you received and shared were blurred or altered in any way, shape, or form to not show nudity of a minor. At the end of the day, those images still show that, and they also show the murder of two children. So to be sick enough to want to look at that, but then share that with other people too, I can't
understand it. Can't wrap my head around it. Sorry, guys.
Well, I mean, to share it back with the family, what the hell was the point of that? What's the point?
Yeah.
What do you think you're doing?
When and they were hide reading behind. This. Sorry.
Yeah. I was just going to say they hide behind a narrative that they care about Abby and Libby and they care about the families and they want to solve this and help solve this. No, you don't. You just don't at the end of the day. If this is how you behave and treat the families and treat Abby and Libby.
What I was going to say is, remember when we were reading this, because 9 times out of 10, guys, we usually do read things together and we'll read them aloud and then discuss them and stuff. I broke down crying. Did I not, guys? I couldn't, and I'm not a big crier, but it killed me. Literally. I can't imagine the family.
All right. So the screenshots that we don't have, but this is stating the screenshots from the iCloud account of Mitch Westerman. The screenshots are of text messages between Mitch Westerman and what he had on his phone listed as Andy. Again, the messages are voluminous, but if the court will read through them, the court will clearly see that Andy is Andrew Baldwin. In the text, Andy talks about writing the Franks memo and how it is a huge endeavor on his part. Remember, and I know somebody argued with me and then was very, very rude and, you know, in chat stuff or whatever, but so I want to clarify again, and I can post the legal info if you guys want to see it in a community post or link it in this chat if you want it, say it after the video. A Frank's hearing has nothing to do with what the strategy is for the defense team that they're going to present to the jury. The only thing a Frank's hearing is for is that a defense team wants to have that the evidence collected at a search warrant and for arrest based on probable cause, that they are arguing that there was not probable cause to go and do the search warrant and or the arrest. And so they put that information in there. And as we've said, when we covered the Frank's memo and stuff in other videos, it had about 100 pages unnecessary because suddenly this defense team decided to throw in all this Odinist stuff, and has nothing to do with throw out the case. Had to throw in the names of teenage girls that were there as witnesses in that Franks hearing. Throw the names of people who were talked to, but were not continued on as suspects whatsoever. And they put all that shit out there. So they revealed stuff in addition to just their theory they wanted out there. This was their way to get around the gag order. Yeah. A regular Franks hearing filing, of course, would be revealed to the public. But all of the rest of the stuff in that Franks hearing was their way to get around the gag order because it was released and then it was out there and then you've got everything floating around after that.
Yep.
So,
but so they said again, there was no gag order necessary, remember?
In December. There was a gag order when this happened, though.
Yeah.
Andy talks about writing the Franks memo and how a huge endeavor on his part. In other messages, Andy encourages Mitch Westerman to reach out to the media and push their narrative. Andy further states that he has already been in touch with Dateline and spoke to them. All of this is a violation of the gag order by Andrew Baldwin and the defense. I mean, you think? I think calling Dateline kind of puts it over the edge, doesn't it?
No kidding.
It's horrific. It is so deliberate. I mean, here's the thing. I suspected that this was deliberate. I did not, in my opinion, I did not believe that Westerman just happened to go into an office and, you know, get pictures on his own randomly and started to send them out to other people. I always felt like it was known that he did that and he was asked to do that.
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, and then because think about that. Right after the Franks hearing got filed, then guess what happened? The crime scene photos were leaking out. It all happened at the same time.
Altered crime scene photos. Right.
Yeah.
So when the state was notified by the leaked crime scene photos in early October 2023, the defense was on a phone conference with the court and gave the court the explanation that Mitch Westerman broke in and stole the photos. When interviewed by the Indiana State Police, Andrew Baldwin stated that he gave the Franks memo to Mitch Westerman to review. Okay, listen to that. He gave the Franks memo. He gave it to him.
Yep.
So right. Then at the hearing on March 18, 2024, the defense implied that Mitch Westerman is now a consultant of the defense.
Amazing.
And any communication between Mitch Westerman and Andrew Baldwin should be considered work product.
I'll be interested to see the documentation, you know, of his employment and stuff, you know?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Right. Well, the defense has consistently altered Mitch Westerman's involvement in the case. Why didn't the defense make the court and the state aware on the October 10th, 2023 phone call that Mitch Westerman was a consultant and that he had access to discovery? It is the state's belief that the defense was trying to conceal or diminish Mitch Westerman's role in the leak. All right, ladies, let's talk about that for a second.
Yeah, I mean, if you're gonna lie, at least be good about it. Like, geez, you'd think with the job role and title that they have, they might be quite good at lying.
Hey, but I'd like that job to go from a criminal to now they a lie. Consultant. Oh, please.
They lie, but they ain't good at it, evidently.
No, they're not.
I think that at the beginning, that I think, in my opinion, Baldwin was worried it was going to affect his job. He was going to be held in contempt already. The first time they were going to throw him out, he goes and gets Hennessy as an attorney that he shows up with. Then he sits here and he tells Westerman, man, you take the fall for it. It's just going to be a misdemeanor or whatever, whatever.
Yeah.
And then once this all gets out, Westerman's, you know, arrested. He's got trial for theft. He's got all this stuff going on. What did Baldwin do to him too? He also mentioned that he was visiting a girlfriend in Franklin, Indiana. So his wife files for divorce. They have kids together. So now Westerman's like, shit, I was probably helping. This is my opinion. I was helping Baldwin. He doesn't want to take the heat and lose his license or be found in contempt. Mm-hmm. I'm taking all the heat. I'm losing my marriage and family.
Losing everything. Oh, yeah.
Keep going, ladies. Keep on with that one.
Oh.
Yeah. So he's losing everything, basically, in the process of this. And what's happening to Baldwin?
Nothing. Nothing. Because you have your little, follower, I guess you'd say, that's willing to do whatever, you ask him to do, I guess.
Yeah.
In my opinion,
Yeah.
I mean, imagine what he's like JSD just said, he's losing his marriage. You know, he may, God
his
knows,
reputation. Time,
his reputation, but he might do time. He may get fined, whatever, And
he's linked to this very large murder case now.
Yes, exactly. Indefinitely,
And right.
Not in a good way, obviously. So the whole thing is just disgusting. I mean, can you imagine if the prosecution side was doing this kind of stuff? I mean,
this is their claim, isn't it? Their claim is that law enforcement and prosecution have hid things, fabricated things, all the way through this just to get Richard Allen arrested. And honestly, I'm still waiting for any shred of evidence that makes me think that way, because I still haven't seen anything.
Well, like we've spoken before, we talk all the time, as I said. I mean, heck, we could do shows just on our discussions, truly, for hours. But, I mean, am I right or not?
Yeah.
But, I mean, honestly, if they were going to pin this on somebody, why wouldn't they have done it already? To someone who's already sitting in jail, to someone already dead. I mean, come on.
The interesting thing as well about this document, where it mentions, that they believe the defense doing this, sharing this stuff with the public and leaking information is going to allow them to have a kind of ever-changing strategy where they're going to gauge the public response. Yeah. And whatever that is, they're going to kind of ease towards that a little bit more. So, if people kind of really shunned this Odinism theory and actually did their research and stuff instead of just jumping onto this and believing everything they've said, would they have then gone in a different direction and possibly, I don't know, maybe they would have chosen Ron Logan or someone else, maybe law enforcement questioned in the beginning that we don't know of, or maybe we do, but nothing happened with that. Like, God knows what would be next if they
Well, remember, the other thing is, we finally get to hear what we should have heard in October of 2023.
Mm-hmm.
But they didn't want to go out there.
Yep. Would you want to face this, in front of, a court full of, going in front of the whole nation, the whole world, really? I mean.
Well, that's exactly it. So, yes, I hear
that people are like, okay, the attorneys can't be thrown out unless they had a trial about what was found. Well, that's what she was trying to have. She was trying to go out there so they would hear the evidence that the prosecutor got from the investigation by the police of what they found, which this is what stuff that they were finding.
Mm-hmm.
Now, people also, the other person, the same person who wanted to kind of go back and forth, said, well, the prosecutor, they shouldn't have arrested Westerman or gone after Westerman because they're not allowed to find work for the case. Okay, well, according to them, Westerman stole it. So they, instead of them saying from the beginning, Westerman is a consultant, which is false. Let me tell you why. It's false because any assistant, any person in addition working for the case that is not a normal employee in their office, right? Like a assistant or something like that, like the judge, or I'm sorry, the other attorney, Jennifer Auger.
Mm-hmm.
When you have somebody else outside of your office who's going to work on a case, you sit there and you submit that name to that person working. And then that person also is going to be paid by the court. So they were never in there. And I'm going to show you how early on the defense filed that they wanted all of their funding and requests for experts closed. Not public,
right.
Not public to the prosecutor, not public to any other officers that of the court. They did this early on. So when they're asking for funding, at that time, they had asked for funding for their expert witnesses. Mm-hmm. They were approved.
Yep.
Judge Gull also approved for their filings of who their expert witnesses are and their funding to be kept from the public. So now that they're raising money continuously from Hennessy doing it.
Yeah.
Who is not a Delphi. He's not a Delphi attorney.
No.
He's an attorney. He is a temporary.
Baldwin and Rosie.
A temporary attorney for Rosie and Baldwin in regards to contempt.
That's it.
He is not Richard Allen's attorney.
Nope.
He is not a tag team come in to help with the Delphi case. But he now sits here and has that fundraiser he put up that, you know, he asked for $25,000. They got past that amount. And then he went and increased it to $45,000. So you don't even know what experts they have coming in, how much mm-hmm. money was approved for them, and you're given money. I don't mean you guys, but people are giving them money and they have no idea.
That just goes to show again that people are failing to do their research. They're just taking their word for things. And it baffles me. It's like, okay, we're not going to believe anything the prosecution says or the judge. But yeah, everything the defense says, we're just going to believe it and we're going to do what they say. Like, did they do some sort of like mind washing that I wasn't aware of or present for? Because it's confusing.
And Silas, you're absolutely right. The stuff about the speedy trial was a bunch of bullshit. Because if you watch this from the beginning and watched what was going on, the continuation kept being requested by the defense. That's why it kept delaying. From the beginning, and again, I'm going to have a few videos to kind of just show you news clips. I'm going to show you a few news clips that show that early on in the case too, right when they first come in, the news reports that Judge Gull reports that at their very first meeting, that they ran downstairs and talked to the media and then went back and wrote a press release. Their very first meeting, They were told that there was thousands of pages of documents of the investigation that they were going to hand over to the defense. And she wanted to give them time to be able to review that so they could accurately decide how long they needed and when the trial date would be.
Absolutely.
And what started happening during all of this? First, the stuff happened with bail. They kept asking for bail. Well, normal in Indiana, if you're charged for double murder, you're not getting bail. You're not getting bail. That's very uncommon. Well, maybe not these days in the United States, but it is very uncommon in Indiana if you're accused of murder for them to just let you out.
I'm not even going to talk about the UK.
Yeah, we won't even go into, don't get us started on that part. But then they sit here, you know, and the whole stuff, they just kept filing the same things. That's like the third Franks hearing they did. The third.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, is anyone else bored yet? Like, come on. Jeez. Sorry.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to laugh, guys. I apologize, but I just
I don't know your comment. Are these just murder sheet talking points? Well, I don't have to watch the murder sheet because I freaking live here, and I have the documents, and I show where I get the information from.
She does research,
and I don't have to get talking points. You know what I have to what I have that a lot of people do? Common sense. That's what I have.
Not everybody needs a source.
There's people listening to people say shit, and you don't even ask where the hell they got the information from.
Exactly. No. I mean, I have to say, that's one thing about Justice Served Daily's channel. If you, and I think most people in chat who are here all the time can agree with me. Maybe some disagree, but I think when you watch her channel, you know that she comes with facts. She shows you facts. She shows you where she got the information. She is not a conspiracy theorist. Will I say that occasionally we may talk amongst ourselves and say in our opinion or something? Yes. But JSD always shows you where she got the information from. And like she says, you can, you know, go to your own mind too, of course. I'm not saying,
and I'm not, this isn't even me talking about Richard Allen. I have clearly said that, and one of the other points that I'm going to also show, one of the videos I'm going to show, because people don't pay attention, so I'm going to do it as a reminder, because I know my justice warriors do, is that we have 19 documents that are still sealed that they never released from the very beginning.
Yeah.
They did not release to the public. So we had 118. There were 19 kept back.
Yeah.
19 documents that were kept back then.
Yeah. And you're still going to tell me that you know everything about Richard Allen and that he's innocent?
And we don't know. I've said this. If there's only this bullet and there's nothing else, right? So let's throw out that he confessed to his wife and his mother and the head of the prison. Let's ignore that. Let's throw that away.
Okay? Yeah, all the witness statements were wrong.
And the paperwork is eaten.
Right? Let's, you know, and I mean, yes, if you hear sarcasm, there is sarcasm in my voice, because these other pieces do lead me to believe that he can be guilty when he sits here and says, the three teenage girls who witnessed me walking down the path, that is time stamped because when they took photos and they know when they saw him and he sees them, he says he sees them. They see him, he sees them, he confirms it. He says what time he's going to be there. He's in there with Dan Dolan. The story is going to come out more about the Orion system, what happened with Dan Dolan, what happened with the info took by him, and why that wasn't investigated more. When did that come out that they go back and look at Orion system, supposedly? September 20th. What two things are also going on in September 20th? We've got Keegan Klein talking.
during a water search that's still going on since August.
Yep.
And now we learn that we have a Lorham that is making a plea deal for CSAM.
And these are facts. These are not things that...
Now, I'm not saying they're 100% connected.
Right.
I'm just saying there is a lot of awful, interesting coincidences happening in this case.
Time. Yep.
Right? A lot of coincidences. Don't know who those could be. Anyway, so let's start back here. A reasonable person can deduct that the defense was trying to hide the fact that the defense was intentionally leaking information. I'm sorry, I agree with that. I agree with that statement.
Yeah, me too. And before this, anything from the prosecution like addressed what the defense had been doing, this is what I felt before they'd even put this in black and white for us to read.
Yeah,
you know, because it was too many coincidences again, right? The exactly. Frank's hearing comes out, then somehow the crime scene thing is leaked out.
And then people who actually do their research again, whoever read the Frank's memorandum, can notice that there are things that are definitely incorrect that we know for a fact. So just going from that, how can you believe the full document, right? And then
everything why does the story change of what Westerman is?
Exactly.
Because here's the thing. If you're supporting the defense, I get that. People want to support, you know, people's rights in this country. That's why, you know, it's supposed to be a fair trial. And a fair trial means nobody leaks shit. Fair trial means this shit doesn't get out the door. Once there's a gag order.
Yep.
Then there's nobody leaking shit after.
But also, like, where's the fair trial for Abby and Libby and all of this? Like, this leaked stuff is hurting them. It's hurting their families. It's hurting this case. It's hurting solving it.
Honestly, it's even hurting the justice
for them.
Yeah, this
is absolutely. Let me ask this: if you're pro defense, let me ask this: how do you think this helps Richard Allen? I don't think it does. Sit here and they prove based on documentation of digital forensics going back and forth between Baldwin and Westerman, Baldwin first lies, then they're trying to make Westerman take crime for it. Then all this shit's hitting the fan, which I find it interesting that Westerman's case has been postponed, right? It's delayed. Is he going to talk? Is he going to say, yep? Is he going to admit, yep, you know what? I'll tell you it. I didn't steal it. Baldwin did give it to me. Well, that's interesting because now Baldwin is trying to say he's a consultant and he gave him access. Well, then that means you lied to the court.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I'm going to be honest with you guys. In my opinion, I know that Rozzy answered the question about the press release. Okay. I know he did. So I know he was knowledgeable and stuff about that. And I don't even think that's that huge of a deal. But Baldwin is the same denominator in every time something happens. Baldwin was the one who, air quotes, accidentally sent it to Woodhouse. Baldwin is the one whose friend Westerman came and accidentally took the photos and then kept sharing all the strategies for the defense and directing Fortson to get it out and what's going on. And every few days, continuously all the way up until October of October 2nd was the date they gave. They kept leaking. They kept knowing more. It wasn't just the photos. They kept communicating. So if you've got anybody that, and it affects no matter what gets out there, it affects the public opinion. So what if somebody hears that the defense team purposefully leaked this because there's evidence? Why would you ask them to stay his attorneys? Because if they're lying, how does that help Richard Allen?
More than that, how much does Richard Allen actually even know what's going on with his defense team? We don't know. How much is he actually being informed of what's going on? You know, what they are putting out, what they are leaking, what they have done to his case. So, yeah, I would ask the same thing like you did. Pro defense people, how is this fair to Richard Allen any more than it is for Abby and Libby?
Justice. I think a lot of them think he's going to get off.
Well, you know what my worry is? I was watching a little bit of the piece because I almost pulled down the Indiana Supreme Court hearing, which I was ready to almost do, because remember in there it says about where one of the judges asked, well, what is to prevent that they go back and they go and decide to do a hearing with these charges and stuff in there? Because some of them were really asking questions about the competency of the attorneys to be doing this. Mm-hmm. And that's a fair question when you think that, you know, what was Baldwin trying to gain? I mean, I know what's a sneaky part is, but what are you trying to gain by lying to the court? You know, the court's going to find out. And they go deeper than this. I'm sure they go way deeper to find out what happened from here, there, whatever. Meaning legally, not contempt. This contempt only has to do with, that's why they didn't worry about listening to YouTube channels during the contempt hearing part. Mm-hmm. Because who else, what YouTuber sent it to what YouTuber who sent it to what YouTuber and then showed it on their shows has nothing to do with where did it originate from. And the origination came from them, from Baldwin to Westerman, from Westerman to Fortson, to Fortson to Mark Cohen. And so that's the main leak. Then after that, they all had their jobs and duties of what they were being asked to do. But how does that help Richard Allen? It doesn't. Nope. Do your strategy. Stop filing goddamn Frank's hearings, for God's sakes. They're not throwing this shit out. They had probable cause. You don't know those 1,000 pages of research that they did, that they kept saying early on, we are just one tip away. They kept saying, we're just one tip away from probably plugging in who would connect all this other stuff that they knew. Who would connect? We'd have no idea. I'm not saying that it's there. I'm not saying it's not there. I'm just saying there's something there, right? We don't know. We have no clue. But when you sit here and then have that suddenly, remember, they don't go arrest him till October. They don't go question him till October. His name pops up September 20th. Well, could it be something popped up and that's why Keegan was pulled in there and something came out of it? Could be. Who knows? Could it be that Lorman was sharing stuff and got stuff from the CSAM he was arrested with and got a plea deal not to serve time? Who knows? That could have come out of there too. Did they stumble upon it miraculously out of the Orion system? I guess that could have happened.
Mm-hmm.
It was there the whole goddamn time. It pissed me off that his name was there the whole time.
Well, and we
don't know why. We don't know what the system was. I've told you guys about the Orion system. If you haven't watched it, go watch the video about that.
Again, but the defense.
How does this help Richard Allen? I'm willing to hear he could not do it. I'm willing, right? If they don't have enough shit, I'll be just like, guys, they didn't have enough shit. I'll say that. I'll admit that to you, which is unlike some people that you watch who's never going to say they're wrong about anything.
No.
I'm just going to tell you what my gut tells me, what in my opinion, looking at some of the stuff means, what stuff has gone on. You know, locally we hear shit too that doesn't get purported in the news, that doesn't get out there. And it's just like people go, oh, well, wait a minute. Did you know they went and searched and looked over here, or they looked over here, or they looked over there? Hell yeah, before it went national. We did. Everybody heard lots of shit. But if they don't have it, I mean,
I'm sorry. They think that the thing they were going to get out is Richard Allen's getting an unfair trial. Richard Allen's not getting this approved. Richard Allen's not having this in there. Well, guess what?
They're being the most unfair to him.
Right. Richard Allen's attorneys lie and contact media while they have a gag order to push a narrative of Odinist. How does that help Richard Allen? Give me a break.
It's like their strategy is to create a massive circus and facade and to make everyone believe so much that it's something else that Richard Allen is not connected to, so he doesn't get anything for this, basically.
You're right, Lynn.
I mean, we know.
And you know what, Lynn? They never released. I'm sorry, I was answering Lynn real quick.
No,
they never released about that car. We all kept wondering, why are they not saying what the car was? We're like, what the hell? Why won't they tell us the car? Everybody knew there was a damn car parked up against the CPS building.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we've known Lynn for a long time.
I know. Lynn's been out there forever.
Yeah.
I don't know how many conversations I've had with Lynn and other things.
I don't know.
At this point,
you can shake your head. That's it.
My worry is this, and I don't care if you're prosecution or defense. I really don't. You know, you believe in what you believe. There's reasons you believe it. Go ahead and believe it. Okay. I believe what it is. But now I worry, as we're getting closer, if there's any chance, okay, if there's any chance at all, that they may offer Richard Allen a plea deal. And here's my question to our viewers. Do you think that Baldwin and Rosie are going to even try to do that for him if he could get less time? When you know that the latest additional attorney they got is to go through all the discovery from the FBI and to question FBI agents on their geolocation, okay, and on the digital forensics, right? So they're going to question the FBI and stuff from that. I will say that is the only advantage that this case has, is that the FBI was involved early on. I'm not saying the head up thing, because you guys know how I feel about stuff going on back then. But the actual FBI field officers who were getting this information in details and looking into it that only the FBI can look.
Like they have a backup, so the defense can attack the police and prosecution all they want, but like they have a backup as well.
Yep. We're not stupid. We know that that's their job, is to defend their client. We right. Understand that. We've talked about that. We understand it. We're not stupid. But all of this coming out like this, this is not good.
No, you know what it is? I'm sorry. And here's the thing. And I gave this example. I did a show with the example about the defense attorneys can lie to save their clients.
Mm-hmm.
And there are cases that I'm sure all of you have followed that you're pissed off that somebody who you believe really committed the murder got away with it, and it was because the defense misled and did something purposely to lie to a jury.
Casey Anthony.
I gave Casey Anthony stuff. And I'm worried that Andrew Baldwin's ego is going to get in the way of what is the best for Richard Allen. That he's trying to be a Jose Baez. He's trying to be, this whole case is about him. Is he going to get this guy off from all this stuff?
It's what he wants to be.
You know, that's like they filed with the Supreme Court. Oh, Judge Gohl is keeping us from a speedy trial, a 70-day speedy trial. And what the hell did the Supreme Court ask them? You've never filed for a speedy trial. Richard Allen signed that document in August. And you guys never filed it. Oh, well, that was part of the strategy. We were going to wait until this, and we were going to catch the prosecutor on his heels. That was the guy's, that was their attorney's exact words who was defending them. It wasn't Hennessy. It was another guy who was presenting that. That's their strategy.
Who requested them do it, though? That's the thing. Whose case is this? Who is it about? You know, and who asked for it to be done? So, I don't know. Just saying.
So, let's see here. All right. So, we've got the reasonable quest for Mitch Mesterman saying about them breaking in the office, being considered being a consultant. That cracked me up. On the Delphi case, whose communication with the defense is protected work product. Now they're not just changing it. Now they want to claim that Westerman, wait a minute, he's a consultant. So anything he has is protective work product.
Yeah.
I had somebody message me about that the other day. No, when he admits that he admitted it. He admitted he did a crime. He took pictures of the photos. And he said it. I think it's after him and Baldwin probably talked, in my opinion. He admits it. So what happens when you stole something? They're going to your house. They're investigating why you took that. They're going to see who you, what you're doing and who you sent it to. If Baldwin, trust me, Baldwin already knew that they were messaging back and forth. So now after the fact, you're going to say, wait a minute, that's work product. And they found out about it. I had somebody argue with me, send me a message arguing about that. It's like, no, they didn't have to go. They didn't have to go to Westerman's house to find out about the Odinist theory, guys. Guess what they had to do? Open the damn Franks hearing. It came out before then. Before the photos were even given. Remember, in the messaging, Baldwin's telling him, wow, this work on this Franks hearing document. Give me a break. The defense intentionally violated the court's order and leaked discovery information in an effort to push their narrative out to the public to gauge the public's response. This was a strategy more by the defense in, or I'm sorry, a strategy moved by the defense in violation of the court orders. The crime scene pictures specifically continue, and this is what I was just talking about, guys. This is how recent that they had to bring it up. The crime scene pictures specifically continue to cause havoc across the internet and re-victimize the families of those involved. As recently as March 28th of 2024, a YouTuber posted the leaked crime scene pictures on his channel to the public and ultimately to the world.
And you know who you are.
Yep.
And that's when I started crying when I read that.
That YouTube video made it back to the family, re-traumatizing them. It has become known that the YouTuber forwarded this picture on to other YouTubers, and they continue to be posted on the World Wide Web. Despite the state and investigators spending countless hours trying to track down all the various outlets the pictures and discovery were leaked to, the damage done by the leaked crime scene photo scenes to be ongoing.
God love those families.
It's awful. So they go through all the different findings and stuff of when you're found in court, you know, when different cases and stuff of things happening, and that they believe that the court should find them in contempt. And remember, this is stuff they did not want out there. They did not want to walk out there. Mainly Baldwin didn't walk out there. In my opinion, I think Baldwin is all the wraparound of this. I think that's why Rosie took the stand and Baldwin didn't. Rosie took the stand, and I think because he didn't send it out to Woodhouse. He didn't send it out to Westerman, who was Baldwin's former employee. He didn't contact Dateline. That was Baldwin. He didn't ask Westerman to get it out to media. Tells him, I already reached out to Dateline. And
mm-hmm.
Yep. Sorry. So here's another page. This is the reply to the third.
Third time's the charm.
they just keep doing this. I mean, they want that evidence thrown out. My reply to that is, you know what? They have.
How about no?
They've already talked about it. They sit here and they falsify stuff. They're trying to say that because the people, the holder in them, when they were interviewed, they don't have the videotape. Well, they don't have the videotapes, but they do have the written notes from the detectives. They found nothing. This was 2017. They didn't find a reason to continue with these guys. So, you know, that's their stuff. So let me show you these. Maybe.
I am not reading 18 pages. I'm just saying right now. Ain't gonna happen. Sorry.
We have read them.
I ain't reading them again.
Here is some stuff of facts that I want to show you. Can if you guys can mute while it plays, and then we'll play afterwards. So here's the first one. Now I did this based on dates. So this is October 28th of 2022, guys. It's after we hear that Richard Allen has been arrested, but we haven't had the press conference yet. So I put these in order for certain information in each one that I want you guys to hear.
We continue right now to follow the breaking news in Carroll County, where Fox 59 has confirmed an arrest in the Delphi murder investigation.
But police have yet to give a formal statement on the suspect. And Fox 59's Courtney Spinelli joining us now here with more on what we do know right now.
Yeah, good evening. In a small community like here in Delphi, news travels fast, but even still today, many people tell us they were stunned by word of an arrest, but it also comes with many people who told us this brings with it a feeling of relief here in this community. The case against Richard Allen, who was arrested in connection to the Delphi murders, is sealed. No information about whether he has been charged or if an initial hearing has been set has been released. Multiple sources tell us after he was booked into the Carroll County Jail, he was immediately taken to a state correctional facility for safety reasons. It's now been 5.5 years since the bodies of Libby German and Abby Williams were found below the Monon High Bridge with no arrests being made. We just went by there to see the memorial that's still a reminder of the deep pain this community has felt after all of this. Allen's neighbors told us they were shocked by his arrest and recalled seeing police activity, which we're told included digging up a fire pit out back of his home last week.
I saw police cars going down there, a couple of police cars, and I never thought much of it.
Now, Indiana State Police have scheduled a 10 a.m. briefing on Monday, expected to update the media and the public with more information related to this arrest. It is important to note that that will be 72 hours after this arrest, which is the limit on how long the state of Indiana can hold a defendant before releasing more information on their whereabouts and any potential charges. And one more thing we do want to note is that while he has been arrested in connection to the Delphi murders, We have not been told by law enforcement what his alleged role was in all of it. Of course, working to dig into that tonight and in the days to come. Reporting in Delphi, Courtney Spinelli, Fox 59 News.
We continue.
Nope.
Even more news came when Judge Benjamin.
I want to point out from that video, the one thing to point out was that they already stated at that point immediately that they had moved him to a state facility for his safety. This is not Judge Gall who did that. This is when Diener was still there. That is when he was still there. So then we'll pick up here. This happened on November 4th, 2022 broadcast.
Even more news came when Judge Benjamin Diener recused himself from the case after expressing concerns for his own safety.
That's probably a good idea.
I think because we all know this person and it's, you know, he's in our community. I think it does need to be sent someplace else.
Allen County Judge Fran Gohl will take over the case from here on out.
Or the judge overseeing the Delphi double.
So that's a shocker, right? That we were shocked when that was happening. Mm.
But look how she's being treated by members of the public. So Diener was right to immediately feel the way he did and that he couldn't take this on, in my opinion.
Well, and if anybody remembers, a lot of the reports and even the terminology that Diener used when he was leaving, because he talked about the bloodlust from the public.
Right.
So we have no idea what type of threats and stuff like that were even coming out.
But being in the YouTube community for Delphi, we already knew what he meant by that. Because we have seen, obviously, the toxic people who talk about this case. And they are threatening and violent. So, you can only imagine what he was facing. So
they've got, you know, they already right away, immediately under Judge Diener, they sit here and they tell him, look, we can't keep him safe here in Carroll County. And now, look, there's a lot of people who talk about Carroll County, whether it's good, bad, whatever. OK, whatever you believe, even if you believe it's bad, don't you think it's probably a good idea to not keep Richard Allen in there because they can't have 24-hour watches on him, if he's suicidal, if the mental illness, you know, that they tried to talk about later.
It's what Tobe Lazenby did say, like they had genuine concern for his safety.
Right. Right. All right. Let's see this one. This was December 2nd, 2022. Now, the October 31st, obviously happened, right? Already we had the press release. Then the attorneys get together November 22nd. And when they get together November 22nd, that is the first hearing that they have, that the defense team and the prosecutor and the judge and the prosecution ask about a gag order. Yeah, it's interesting. I'll let you hear this.
For the judge overseeing the Delphi double murders case has issued a gag order banning the parties involved from talking to the media, at least until a hearing in January.
Yesterday, Judge Fran Gohl scheduled a January 13th hearing on the state's motion for a gag order and Richard Allen's defense team's request for change of venue. Now she's issued an order granting a gag order pending that hearing. Now that means the attorneys, law enforcement, or family members are not legally allowed to talk about the case.
Now, as for the change of venue, attorneys argue that moving the case would prevent a tainted jury pool. They say media coverage of the case would make it hard to find someone who has not had enough knowledge to form an opinion of this case. Allen is charged with two counts of felony murder, accused of killing Abby Williams and Libby German while trying to kidnap them as well.
near the Monon High Bridge in 2017. Now, you can read about the evidence that police believe connects him to their deaths and what took so long for police to file charges on our website, fox59.com. Remember, the tip line in this investigation is still open right now. That number is right there on your screen. You can find it and the email address you can also use on our website, Fox 59.
So...
Or the judge...
Sorry, it doesn't like to clip when I want to. So you've got... Right after they do the press release and stuff, that's why she enters a temporary gag order until they go to trial, because they weren't supposed to go or to their next hearing, I should say. So when they're going to do the hearing in January, she in December has to turn around and issue that because they already wrote a press release after they told her they didn't want, you know, they're not going to try this in the media. They go downstairs. You all saw the famous, they come down the stairs. They're talking. They say all this stuff. He didn't do it. They don't have enough, blah, 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 blah. And then they go back and they release a press release, written press release after that. So that's why she issues that. So let's look at, this is on December 12th. Okay. December 2nd, she issues that gag order. Right? Now, watch this one.
Attorneys for the suspect in the Delphi murders case want their planned defense kept secret from everyone, including the prosecutor. Less than 3 hours ago, we learned a judge approved Richard Allen's attorney's request for money to pay for expert testimony. Now, the attorneys also asked the judge to order court personnel and court reporters to keep information in that court hearing confidential. The next hearing in that case is scheduled for January 13th.
Wait, what? December 12th of 2022, they went and requested their funding. Their funding got approved of what they requested for December 12th of 2022. They're asking, after they release a press release and a gag order has to be put in place, 10 days later, they're like, okay, we don't want any of our stuff going public. We don't want our witnesses who we're calling.
Nope.
We don't want their names out there. We don't want them to know who they're for. And we don't want the amount of money. They don't want that as they get the approvals. They don't want it out there, right? They don't want it out there. Now, before that all happened, we knew, because it hadn't been issued yet, that there had already been $6,000 that were given for two different expert witnesses for the defense. But they wanted it even more solid, closed. Okay. But here's the thing. When you file something in the courts for Indiana, so when you guys see the dates in the My Case, in the Indiana My Case, and you see that filing and you see when this document gets in there, okay, the attorneys file that stuff electronically and or their assistants in their offices.
Mm-hmm.
When those get filed, they have to mark them certain ways. So, for example, the Franks hearing, we already know the judge was pissed about because it should have been redacted. And if it wasn't redacted, then they should have made it not go public until it was redacted, that gave witnesses' names and other people that they spoke to that they gave out, Holders and everybody else. So when you guys are seeing stuff filed by the defense right now, and you see an ex parte is submitted, but you can't see a name. When you see another thing for expert witness and you can't see a thing, it's because their requests are being honored that it's not in there. But remember, they're trying to now say, and some of their followers are, hey, you know what? The prosecutor was, it was against the law, which the prosecutor didn't go investigate it. Holman went investigate it, Indiana State Police, of somebody who was accused of stealing evidence in a case that has national attention. They go to the house and now they're going to say, Westerman is a consultant and you took work materials.
You got yourself exposed to work materials. No, you exposed all of us to your work materials. You've told everybody that you think it's oldness. Trust me. Now, the other question I had somebody ask, does that mean they have to stay with the oldness theory when they go to court? Nope. Absolutely not.
Nope. Can change to whatever they want it to be.
They can change a whole different strategy if they want to go in there. If they want to go in there and say that Richard Allen is insane, which is one of the things that people thought he was going to do. That was the reason they were trying to say he should be removed from one jail to the other. And they kept bringing up his mental health. And the Judge Gall had said, okay, well, right now I'm going to protect this unless you guys bring up mental health again. If you guys bring up and have stuff that's going to bring up his medical stuff, then I'm going to make it that the prosecutor can as well. So this December 12th, 2022, everybody donating money. Here's my question. This isn't supposed to be public. How can they make teenage witnesses' names public and people who aren't being charged with murders names public, but yet you can't see who donates to their fund to support Richard Allen public?
Or, right?
Why can other innocent people's names be thrown out there, but the donors aren't public? Why?
What about writing checks directly to Hennessy? What is that about? I'm sorry. Maybe I went ahead too far. I apologize, JSD, but like, what? Where are they coming from?
I mean, I have no idea. I mean, and what's going to happen if they don't use all that money? Do you know for certain? Mm-hmm. Have they guaranteed they're going to prove to you they use that money? Because let me tell you, the whole Carroll County and the taxpayers of Indiana, and specifically that county, already is having to pay. That Carroll County alone is supposed to pay $2.1 million was what it was initially budgeted for. Now, did they get any higher raise from the town? I don't know. But that was the initial budget for the Delphi case. $2.1 million.
I can't even imagine what it's at right now.
For one person. This is not the dream team, people. This is his public defenders. He doesn't have the money. So he was assigned these public defenders.
Right.
Who, again, I ask you, if something happens and they see a lot of evidence, and they'll know more than we do. I don't know. But if they see that there's a lot of evidence and Richard Allen could get less time, do you think and believe that Baldwin, I'm not even gonna blame Rosie. I don't think Rosie's in all the, on this shit. Baldwin, do you think his ego is going to let this just settle with the plea deal? Or does his show must go on happen regardless of what he has done to purposely leak out stuff to people? How is that fair to Richard Allen? See what you guys are doing? You're making me argue for Richard Allen, for God's sake.
Attorneys.
June 28th, 2023.
And another big story we're following tonight. For the first time, we know a knife was used in the murders of Abby Williams and Libby German in Delphi. That's just one of the details revealed after a judge released nearly 300 pages on the investigation into their deaths. The documents unsealed this afternoon include new information about the 2017 murders, what led to Richard Allen's arrest, and what's happened in the months after he was taken into custody. Among the revelations, though, Allen admitted multiple times to killing Abby and Libby.
And now we have a copy of the search warrant for Allen's home. Our Max Lewis dug into these documents earlier today and breaks down some of the new details that we've learned.
We knew that Richard Allen was interviewed by a DNR officer in the days following Abby Williams and Libby German's murders. He told that officer he was on the trails. However, for some reason, that interview never went anywhere until September 2022 when it was re-examined. About a month later, in October, Allen and his wife were interviewed by the Delphi investigators. During that interview, both confirmed that Allen owned guns and a blue Carhartt jacket, similar to one worn by the suspect in the photo and video taken on the Monon High Bridge the day of the murders. The day of the second interview, detectives applied for and were granted a search warrant for Allen's Delphi home. Inside, they found a .40 caliber handgun and .40 caliber bullets. The state police lab claims a bullet found at the scene between the girls' bodies was cycled through a gun found in Allen's home. The evidence log also says police seized those 13 knives along with dozens of pieces of clothing and numerous electronic devices. The other major revelation from the document dump is that Allen repeatedly admitted to killing the girls during prison phone calls with his wife and mother. Documents detail a call between Allen and his wife on April 3rd. The state writing that Allen, quote, admits several times within the phone call that he committed the offenses as charged. His wife, Kathy Allen, ends the phone call abruptly. This happened around the same time Allen's defense team claimed his mental and physical health was on the decline. Documents reveal that after that phone call, Allen began eating papers from his attorneys. They also say he refused to eat or sleep and then broke the tablet he used to make phone calls. After being evaluated by psychiatrists, prison officials said Allen's behavior began to return to normal. His attorneys have repeatedly tried to have him moved to the local jail in Cass County, but Judge Fran Gall has yet to make a final ruling.
And that was our Max Lewis reporting. Allen's defense team has asked the judge to throw out all the evidence found during the execution of the search warrant because it lacked probable cause that Allen had committed a crime. We're also waiting for a decision on that motion as well. 118 court filings were made public as part of the judge's order today. Another 19 will remain under seal.
One of the big debates in this case right now is over where Allen is being held. His defense team argues his physical and mental condition have deteriorated while he's been at the Westville Correctional Facility. One of the documents unsealed today was a letter from an inmate at Westville Correctional. The letter claims Allen was being abused and mistreated by inmates and guards. The letters said that guards would call Allen a kid killer. Allen's defense team wants him moved to a county jail. The judge took their arguments under advisement at his latest hearing 2 weeks ago.
Tonight, Libby German's sister is reacting to the release of these documents. Keep in mind, we haven't heard from the family in months after the judge issued a gag order in the case. Today, Libby's sister, Kelsey German, tweeted, "Remember, as these documents are being released, that family members and friends of Abby and Libby can see your post. Justice for Abigail Williams and Libby German is what this is about at the end of the day. Don't let his name be heard more than theirs today or ever. Abby and Libby were best friends and were killed when they went on a hike on the Monon High Bridge. In February 2017, the girls were both in eighth grade at Delphi Community Middle School. In the years since the murders, people around Delphi, the country, even the world have seen their story and hoped along with their families for justice. Now that trial is scheduled to start in January in Carroll County, and the jury will come from Allen County.
We've posted all of the documents that were unsealed today on our website at fox59.com, where you can also find all of our coverage of this Delphi murder investigation.
So let's talk about this one. And I wanted to keep this one in its entirety for this reason. One, you heard them say, when the document were going to be released, right? The defense wanted the documents released to the public. The same defense who doesn't want their stuff out there wants all the rest of the documents released. So they thought that this should be out in the public. So 118 of those documents were released, right? All these filings. 19 are not. 19 we have not seen that were from the very beginning. Now, they were talking very early on that Richard Allen started to look in poor health. He looked horrible. Now, I'm going to throw this out there. A total speculation here. But if he did commit the murders and you get arrested for the murders, which he just did in October. And it's 3 months later, and you're in prison, and the reality has hit you. I don't think you're going to look like you feel very well, because I bet you you don't. They also sit here and talk about how the documents reviewed show that in April of this same year of 2023, he sits here and he tells his wife, and we all know he told his wife several times, he told his mother, and he told the warden of the prison. This, in my opinion, is where I think that Richard Allen could have been. At that point, remember, his attorneys hadn't seen him a lot. Remember that? And they were really talking. Baldwin was like, oh, my God, you know, he's so far away and I got to drive out there. And, you know, and then try to sit down and meet with them and go through evidence and stuff with them. Mm-hmm. At this point, they were finally sitting down with him and going through the evidence that the judge had given them since they got on scene November of 2022. That the thousands of pages of documents, which that's their job, they're supposed to go through to see the timing of the case and what they need to do. What are they doing? What have they been doing? They still want the probable cause. As you know now, they still want the probable cause thrown out. They keep filing a Franks hearing, a Franks hearing, a Franks hearing. Three of them that they keep responding. That's why I'm not even going to read them to you. Read the first one over again, for God's sakes. It's the same shit. It's the same ditto, ditto, ditto.
Mm-hmm.
But they talk about then after he has this call with his wife, they hand him pieces of paper to review that have evidence against him. He is eating them. Does he know that was a copy? I'm just saying.
Oh, God. Well, if you haven't been eating, JSD, you know.
Well, and here's the thing. They say that after he finally is getting help, right, with the doctors, with the psychologists, whatever, mm-hmm. there, which you can get in the state prison. They can't exactly. get that in the little local prisons. I'm going to tell you why, or jails. Now, you're going to go, oh, yeah, they can. JSD, they could. Sure, they can, if they have enough people to do it. They don't have somebody to take all day to go get Richard Allen out of jail, drive him to a, you know, local hospital psychiatrist, talk to the psychiatrist and drive the psychiatrist back. You're talking, these jails only have a few employees. I know, especially in the U.S., wherever you're in the U.S. in the country, there are low amounts of police officers.
And he's a high value prisoner. You don't have it
fulfilled anymore.
Yeah, he's and
a high
those
value prisoner.
Again, those 19 pages, we don't know what's in them. Like, is that why the defense is working so hard to try and get this removed?
Exactly.
Something in there as well, we don't know.
Those are important papers.
So let's also bring up this fact. The other things we don't know is from after which I'm gonna guess that after the probable cause. Because they're not going to tell you guys what evidence they're arguing with that actually points to Richard Allen, right? Other than the bullet, because the bullet was released in the what they released in the probable cause affidavit. I'll put it that way.
Yeah.
So they can mention to the bullet, but they're not going to tell you anything else that was found during the search warrant or that was tested. And we know all the things that they took out. We've gone over that stuff and went item by item of everything that they took. All the phones, all the clothing, and the car.
That we know of.
Right. Exactly. His water bottle he was drinking from that they very much so pulled for, we know that was for DNA.
Yeah.
But they took his car. And when we went through that, they took his car to an FBI office. And it was a building, and that building is where the labs and stuff are. And they had cut out and swabbed inside the car in very specific places. They cut out in the tire well of the trunk of the car. They swabbed on the passenger floor of the car. And there was a swab that was taken off the seat belt, the cross belt and across your stomach of those areas. Now, I'm going to guess that the reason that those were very specific could be due to luminol. And a lot of times you see labs will pull something in, they spray with luminol, it glows, they cut that out, and now they have to start testing that for DNA. Obviously, this is a speculation, but they took those out for a reason. So if they get the probable cause thrown out, guess what? All of that evidence, all of it is gone. Yeah. Anything they got from the home, anything they got from the car, anything they got from his cell phones, anything they got from digging the backyard in the burn pit.
All those drives.
His DNA. How many of that stuff.
Oh my God.
Gone. Because they're trying to say there was a lie, and the biggest lie, they're saying they omitted, you know, Odinist stuff. Guess what? There was a lot of people they looked into. They did a lot of, there was over 70,000 tips given. And honestly, I'm sure there's lots of tips that led to lots of different things and different avenues and stuff, because there is so much crap that is connecting people together here. CSAM, drugs, right? All kinds of shit. But when you look at that, you also have that you've got people who are just also high school like rumor mill calling in all kinds of bullshit. And repeatedly, you know, but they have to go through all of that. So once they sit here and they go and find Richard Allen in September 2022, and they go, wait a minute, here this guy is, however way they did it, Orion, Keegan, Lorman, whatever. They see him. Now they got to go, okay, does he fit? Does this piece of the puzzle fit with the evidence that we have? So from that time frame until they go to question him in October, they must have found that. There's 19 documents that we don't know of. Now, remember early on, they also did say that they thought there could be somebody else involved. And one of the reasons they wanted to keep some stuff sealed, because it could reveal about somebody else who could be involved. Some of that could be that. We definitely know that the autopsy isn't going to be there, right? We're only going to hear what pieces the defense wanted you to hear. That's why they leaked it.
And another big.
So here is the just the date, October 19th of 2023. This stuff was all the hearing, the bail, the Franks hearing, all of this stuff just kept going and delaying and delaying when this should have been heard. We get to October 19th and the hearings are supposed to go on, which they will. But there is going to be the information that they found out about contempt. She's in the office. She had already gave them a heads up about what was going on in a phone call meeting prior to. And then we know she had this. When they heard that they were going to be going through this, well, I shouldn't say they. When Baldwin heard, he automatically quit and withdrew by phone. He didn't even show up. Then you've got Rosie, who's like, okay, well, you know, and I'm sure he thought about it because he's like, I didn't do anything wrong, I'm sure. I didn't say that. I'm just saying he probably did, because it sounds to me like it's all Baldwin. So here's when this date happened, that they would not come out. That would have been a trial, of listening to the evidence the prosecution is going to tell her, guess what? They're leaking it. And everything we just read, he knew, but we didn't get to know publicly. And it was being public on television. They wanted everything else on television, right? Baldwin wanted it in the news. He wanted the media to cover it, but not if it was about him.
Thank you. You may be seated. We on? All right. We are on the record in State of Indiana versus Richard Allen, 08-CO-1-2210-MR1. Thank you for your patience, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. McClellan, Mr. Luttrell, for your patience. We've had an unexpected turn of events, ladies and gentlemen. Earlier this afternoon, the defense attorneys have withdrawn their representation of Mr. Allen. Mr. Baldwin made an oral motion to withdraw. I granted that oral motion to withdraw, and Mr. Rosie will be submitting a written motion to withdraw, I'm assuming within the next couple of days. They have confirmed with the court that Mr. Allen's financial situation remains static, meaning he is continuing to be entitled to appointed counsel. I will reach out to public defenders to make that appointment. As Mr. Allen is now without counsel, I've ordered him transported back to the Department of Correction. Mr. McClellan, I know that we have already scheduled a hearing in the Carroll Circuit Court, October 31st at 9 a.m. I'd like to maintain that hearing if we can, please. I think at that point we can have counsel appointed. I'd like to set a new trial date, obviously. I don't believe counsel will be prepared within the next couple of months to try a case of this magnitude in January. So we'll set dates for the trial. I think we need to set a date as well for the suppression hearing that was filed now by former counsel. I have asked the attorneys to provide all of the discovery previously provided to back to the state of Indiana. I know I entered a protective order on the discovery, and honestly, I don't remember when that was. I think it was in April of this year, perhaps, maybe sooner. But the attorneys have been ordered to provide all of that discovery back to the state. And if you would maintain that until such time as it can be turned over to successor counsel, I would appreciate that, Mr. McClellan. I've also asked the defense attorneys to cooperate with successor counsel. They're not required to do that, but I think that they will in the best interests of Mr. Allen. They're not required to provide any of their work product, but they will be required and have indicated that they will cooperate with successor counsel. So obviously, without counsel, Mr. Allen's hearing cannot proceed. I apologize that I know many of you have been waiting for several hours. I know, Mr. McClellan, you and your staff, and you had some witnesses here that came earlier to have the hearing, but clearly this is outside of our control. So is there anything, Mr. McClellan, that you'd like to state for the record?
No, Your Honor, I think we can address the other issues at the October 31st court date.
All right. With that being said, then, we are in recess. Thank you. I'll see you in October.
All right.
I'll never forget that. We're waiting to finally hear something, and then we sit here and not get it.
It was a shock.
And, I mean, the other thing I was interested in actually on that day was, okay, if they did something in contempt, McClellan had witnesses that showed up to talk about what it was. I mean, I'm sure that one of them is was Holman, right, to talk about the actual contempt hearing and all that kind of stuff. And again, it wasn't about, you know, who floated to then this YouTuber and this to YouTuber and this YouTuber. Based on the iCloud and message information that McClellan submitted to the court that shows the messages back and forth, Andrew Baldwin was messaging Mitch Westerman a former coworker, a friend, in this iCloud communication. He's asking him, we need to get this narrative out there. I need you to contact media. I've already contacted Dateline and I've already spoke to them. Mitch Westerman, then I'm sure because of the reason of they want to get it as much removed from Baldwin as they can. So Mitch Westerman sends it to Robert Fortson, lives in Fishers, the man who commits suicide after the state police come and talk to him. Does anybody give a shit that a man lost his life because of this shit?
How many times have I said that? Is someone going to be held responsible for that? I don't know.
So
I know it was his choice, but.
And I apologize. I got to fix it myself because I'm going to go crazy if I don't fix it because it's just driving me nuts. Okay, there we go. Then you've got Robert Fortson, who they continue, McLeland shares and says that Robert Fortson continuously is communicating back and forth with Westerman, and he's knowing stuff as it happens. It continues all the way until October 2nd. So that right after they share the information with them about the professor from Purdue, who the defense has never spoken to, who the 2017 officers went to ask this professor's opinion of, look at this crime scene. Could this be ritualistic? Could this be a signature? Those are two different things, people. Could this be just trying to cover up the body? Because everybody wants to talk about the sticks. Nobody wants to talk about leaves. I don't know if there were leaves and stuff on there. But I know that when they had people investigating and looking, one of the people that was involved in the search party too sat there and had shared information early on. Why? There was no gag order. Do I think he should have done it? No. There was a lot of people who were kind of sharing some of those details. Details, not their details, but his details.
Everyone has had their own speculation, rumor, or theory over the years too, but you know, no evidence. It's just a theory.
So then you've got Fortson still knowing updated strategies of the defense team, knowing about the interview that was just sent to them 3 days later after they look, 3 days after prosecution sends the interview with the professor, Robert Fortson knows about it. He's talking about it. Then he shares it with Mark Cohen. Then their job is, from Andrew Baldwin, what is this job? Andrew Baldwin wants Mitch Westerman to contact news media. I've contacted Dateline. I've already talked to them. You go out and reach this. Push this narrative out to the news media. They want to gauge how the public responds to it. Why? Because if it doesn't seem responsive, which with the Franks hearing, you know, people weren't really thinking one thing or the other, but guess what would help them? I don't know, maybe an altered crime scene photo that makes, it's going to make it look more like what scenario they're trying to describe. And then what Fortson and Mark Cohen supposed to do? They, you know, they're supposed to get it out to in social media, to YouTubers and Facebook groups and probably in Reddit and, you know, all that kind of shit.
Mm-hmm. And the family.
Back to the family. And what happened every time? the media kind of ran with that as well, like, and we're not from the area, but I can only imagine how much this was reported in the news, the leak, the Odinism, the defense stuff, blah, blah, blah. So.
Yeah, I get it, Peter. I mean, obviously, Fortson decided overall to commit suicide. Get it. My dog again. But. Same one dog that likes to bark. But Fortson was, you know, an Air Force officer, right? And there's honor and stuff in that. And you believe in the law and you believe in that stuff because there's honor from that. And when you have stuff coming out, plus we don't know what other deal was going on with that. I mean, he lived in the Fishers area. He actually didn't go by Robert Fortson, but I'm not going to say what his name was here in that area. And but he, his family came from Kokomo most recently, but his family originated from Delphi. So how did he get involved? What was their thing? Now, Fortson and Westerman both lived in Hamilton County. Westerman lived in Westfield, Indiana. Robert Fortson lived in Fishers, Indiana. But because of those leaks, because of what's going on, because of everything in there, I mean, that right after he's interviewed with the Indiana State Police, that happens to him. I mean, he could have other stuff going on, but then you've got this happening. I mean, look at Westerman. His family and everything's all to hell right now. He's being charged. Which, to be honest with you, I don't think Baldwin's changing the story. I think that was, in my opinion, I think that is the story. I think that Baldwin deliberately wanted this shit out to create the leak. He asked Westerman to do it. And when he found out that they found out about it, he didn't want to go out in the court. He didn't want it broadcasted on television. That's why he didn't show up. That's why he called in.
Yep.
They don't let the trial happen to hear the evidence, to hear what if the does the prosecutor have something? He knew the prosecution had something. So what does he do? He quickly is probably, hey, man, just tell him you took the photos and I didn't know. Which, if you think about it, he could have come back and easily said, you know what, I was consulting him on it. And, you know, he took the photos. But he didn't. So now you guys, you've heard what was read. We don't have all the documentation. We don't have all the images. But we have the gist of what that is. And the timing of what that is. So now you have to ask yourself, 1 week prior to this trial, because not because Judge Gull wants to in the as far as timing is concerned, but she only has 30 days to respond to the memorandum submitted by the defense team, which was Hennessy, which had nothing to do about defending them about these leaks. It was all about, you know, Delphi trial this, Delphi trial that, leak out more this. It had nothing to do with it. So now you have to ask yourself, should they be found in contempt? I'm watching to see what the census is here. Right. Regardless if you're prosecution or defense team, you still have ethics and professionalism to not hurt your case. And I will keep arguing this. I don't think these antics help Richard Allen. The only people they had to present this theory to is to the jury.
Absolutely.
And they want to turn, I go, oh, but they deleted this stuff. They're not going to, you want 70,000 interviews that they have? Like, you, they're acting like you have to present everybody that you ever interviewed.
I mean, I have to respond to Peter here. Peter, if you watch from the very beginning of, if you replay the video, I think more things will make sense as far as what JSD and the panel are speaking about. But it says in the paperwork that they deliberately leaked this information out because they wanted to get a consensus of what the public's feelings would be. They wanted to get a response.
They wanted to get a gauge for if they would buy into that.
Exactly.
And here's the thing. Yes, we do not see the text of the communique. We see the text. They tell and mention that Westerman contacted Fortson. Now, they have not read, and we do not have all of the text yet at all. But if he's will, if Baldwin is messaging in the iCloud to Westerman, hey, go reach this out to the media. We need this narrative out there, push this narrative. Then why don't you think Westerman would try to get other people help him to get it out there in social media? Because see, what does Westerman have to do? Westerman worked with Baldwin. They have to get it as many times removed from Baldwin as they can. Well, Westerman's too close to Baldwin to know that. So Westerman can go contact media. Media will keep their sources quiet, not say who's telling them anything. But if they sit there and they want it put out there on social media, then we don't know what conversations are going back and forth, or if Baldwin said, get other people to put it out there on YouTube channels, on Facebook groups, on Reddit. But I don't think it's too far-fetched to say that could be in there. Now, once we see everything, that could be a different story.
I don't think
Rosie had anything to do with it, Jinx, too. I mean, I think it's all Baldwin. I really do.
The ex parte, though, that Nick McClelland read, it was actually sent to him by mistake. So you would kind of assume that it was something that was directed to yourself. So that one, again, it was leaked by mistake. It was not leaked. It was a mistake. It was sent to him by mistake. So, you know, not really sure.
Sorry, Jinx just made me laugh. Look at it comment.
What did she say?
Oh, JSD.
I love Jinx. What did she say?
And me, bring it up. Oh, you'll find it.
Is it this one?
Oh. I just laughed at
her. Let's see.
You'll know when you find it.
Come on, what did she say?
I'm not
oh, God.
It. You just read it.
It was an accident. Oh, Jinxie, I love you, honey. It's a cute. Oh, God. And Peter, I'm not, please don't think I'm trying to pick on you or anything like that. I'm just trying to make points about.
Right. You know, they're just debating with you, Peter. Don't feel.
Yeah, please.
Don't feel shunned.
No, please don't feel that way at all, because I'm not trying to.
Keep rereading it.
I mean,
let me see. What about reading ex parte?
That's what I was responding to.
But ex parte just means you're keeping that private. All the latest filings that have been done, and I don't know if you were here at the beginning of the video or not, all of those were done because the judge granted the defense team, when they asked for their witnesses and their budget and approval for expert witnesses, when it got approved, they asked for it also for all of their stuff to be kept from court people and the prosecution, for they would not know what theory and or, you know, what tactics they were going to use. Yet they released the Odinist stuff all by themselves in the Franks hearing, which shouldn't have been a part of that. And again, it does not, that does not mean that's what they're going to use when they go to court. They could use anything else. Thank you, Jinx.
Ouch. Rick Snay's daughter. That's cute. That's funny. Did you see that page? Oh, gosh. It's cute.
Sorry, I'm trying to catch up with everybody here.
No, definitely. Everybody's wonderful. And again, Peter, you know, please, like I said.
Actually, CJK, you know, here's the thing. That ex parte, they did not mark that document confidential. They're right. Supposed to. When they file the documents, they and put it in the system, they have to mark it so. Because otherwise, the court clerk just pops it in there, whatever they filed it as. So, like, that's why the judge mm-hmm. was pissed that the Franks hearing got out there. Because a Franks hearing, the clerk sees it, right? And she just submits it. Well, she is not sitting here reading all the way through, looking that all of a sudden they put their whole Odinist theory inside there. They named teenage witnesses who saw him out to everybody. They name other people who have not been named points of interest or suspects or anything whatsoever. And they revealed all of it. Why? Because they were also supposed to redact anything like that. They chose not to do that. So when they had an ex parte, it would have stayed in there if they would have shown it was confidential info. I don't even know if that's the right term, but it's them blocking the document, so it's not shown outright.
That was what I was responding to Peter about before, though, too, JSD, was that it was, you know, sent an error because they made the error by not making it confidential. So, but that's, you know.
I mean, honestly, they're not doing a very good job trying to be confidential.
No. Actually, Lynn actually made a good point earlier too, in regards to, I guess, the funds that they are trying to raise, you know, privately for Richard Allen's defense and so forth. She was saying that actually the funds are considered, correct me if I'm wrong, Lynn, when I read your comment, that it will not be given back to the donors. It just stays with them. So, you know.
Somebody argued this with me, and I can't tell you how I know, but I can tell you that Miss Page and Mama Bear will confirm that I know some stuff about nonprofits. And
a little bit.
So let me tell you this. That is not tax deductible, people. In order for it to be tax deductible, you have to be donating to a 501c3. It is not tax deductible. I don't care what the hell you call it. You can call it a gift. You can call it a donation. You can call it whatever you want to. Here's the clue. Hennessy is not a non-for-profit. Giving money to Richard Allen is non-for-profit. Them using the word of giving a gift, if you just want to give this gift, that means there's no takey-backsies, right? Yeah. You gave me a gift. There's the gift. The taxes aren't going to write off because you donated money to me. I don't have to give it back, right? He doesn't have to give it back if he's guilty. You find out he's guilty on the other side of it, and they found DNA, and it's in his car, and he had pictures, and he had all kinds of shit, and you find out he's guilty, and you're like, oh, shit, he's guilty. You can't take that back. You can do it a gift. You can have that to the gift. It is not in there. It is not a 501c3. Yeah. If it was, they are required by law to give you their 501c3 number in which you would contribute to. And then that's what you would use for your taxes and your receipt. And they would be required that when you make that donation electronically, it would automatically send you a message back, and it would say, thank you for your donation to blah, blah, blah organization. And it would show tax ID number, da, 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 da. And that's how you get to claim that tax deductible.
Right.
So because I showed you, and if you guys didn't see that, please rewind and go look. I showed the video where Judge Gull approved that the expert witnesses, the funding, and everything was requested by the defense to be sealed, which it has been. You don't know how much that they were getting funding. The only one we know about is the first time when they met and there was $6,000 approved for a tech expert. And I can't remember what the second one was. Ballistics. Digital tech and ballistics. $2.1 million beginning budgeted trial out of Carroll County. Yes, the altered photos to make it look what they wanted to look, their scenario is sick. And, you know, and everybody should think about that for a minute. I want you to imagine if it's your children or if it's your family relative, your niece, your nephew, your cousin, the neighbor. Ugh. I want you to imagine that.
Makes me.
And I want you to imagine, and I've showed this clip. There's a little short video I created called Why Does It Matter If the Crime Scene Photos Are Leaked? Well, I have the clip of the FBI agent talking at the beginning of the case. About the evidence. And that means a lot. But I want you to think about forever. Think about if this was about CSAM or a snuff film. Ugh. They just let it get out there for people like that to see that shit.
Exactly. Which is illegal for it to be in your possession, mind you.
Yep.
And to send it.
Peter, but that's you assuming that what the and I'm not arguing with you. I'm debating, so don't think I hate you because I don't. But that's you assuming that what the defense is telling you is true. Then why are they not showing you the names and who they already have coming? Why don't they put that in the funding, in the information when you donate? Who do they have? There were certain ones that can be not approved. It could be because it's irrelevant or it's not part of the case or you don't need that many reps, whatever the reason can be. But we don't know how many. And I think it was another ploy of public information to get out because they want to constantly push out that Richard Allen is not getting a fair trial. And you know what? I'm going to agree with them on that. You know why? Because these guys are worried about what their little tricks are to do to pause the case. And I believe they're going to try to pause this case. I have a feeling that they're going to turn around and they're going to say, oh, we don't have enough time. We don't have enough time to get ready. We were given multiple months to get ready to see how much time, review the initial evidence, given all that time for it. You know, oh, we were taken off to stop working on it for, you know, these couple of months. And then when they came back in, guess what? They had till October of this year to get ready because that was the rescheduled date. They go fight it in the Supreme Court and go, we want a 70-day trial. What does she say? What do they say back to him? You didn't file for a quick trial. You didn't file for a speedy trial. Richard Allen signed that in August. Why didn't you file it? Oh, that's part of our strategy. We're going to catch the prosecutor on his heels. I think you're caught on your heels. Because the one trick show that I know that Baldwin has, because he's done it to other murder cases here in Indianapolis, is that he gets the probable cause dropped out. Now, if the police don't follow procedure and it could be thrown out, then it's horrible, but it does. And he got it thrown out from a person who allegedly murdered three people. So all the evidence was thrown out, and that's how he got that case and that guy clear. But that's now amazing. It's just repeatedly filing and filing and filing and filing the Franks hearing over and over again.
If anybody wants to peruse that last one that was filed with the 18 pages and read repetitiveness
it's over, in community
and over and over again, yes, please feel free, because it blatantly, to me, in my opinion, and I think we've all discussed it amongst ourselves, it blatantly to me shows what they're going to request a delay. But that's in my opinion. And knock yourself out reading it.
And I know I don't keep track of it, but all I do know is that they turned around and originally said they wanted $25,000. And now they've increased it that they now need $45,000. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and you can donate it too. And there's people pushing that out. This is a public defender. They're not the dream team. You don't get unlimited whatever.
Yeah, I mean, that was self-paid for. It's totally different.
Right. They and Judge Gull, people keep talking about Judge Gull not approving anything. While this went live to go fund for experts, they just filed for an additional attorney, a third attorney, the attorney Jennifer Auger, because she's going to be put in charge of the interviewing the FBI agents on the geolocating information and stuff like that that they did. They wanted to argue, you know, when this stuff came in for the FBI. Well, guess what? The FBI takes their time to get their shit together, and they'll bring it when they bring it. I mean, I want to make sure we're always respectful of everybody's different opinion. Only thing I can't handle is don't want people hurting the family.
Yes.
They've had enough.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we want justice for Abby and Libby.
Peter, technically they can. Even though they filed a 70-day hearing. Now, that doesn't mean it'll get approved.
Right.
They could go and ask for a delay. And this is the reason I say that, Peter, because if you look at everything they keep submitting, they keep saying, well, we didn't get this till late, and we didn't get this till late, and we didn't get this till late. And by the way, they're raising more money to hire experts they don't even have set up yet. So if they're raising the money and we're less than 5 weeks from the trial, mm-hmm. where's $45,000 going?
But it does have to be approved.
Right. They have to submit approval for a delay, yep. Which they filed. That was their tactic. They thought they were going to catch McLeland not ready. But I think the only person who's not ready is them.
Yeah. Agreed.
And I think that when this goes down, you know, and I don't think it's fair. I don't think it's fair to Richard Allen, Peter. Do you think if they leak this stuff that it's fair to Richard Allen?
And based on their behavior and their pattern of behavior so far, like, it wouldn't surprise me if they do say, yeah, we're not ready, because it doesn't look like they are. Mm-mm. So.
Not my opinion either. Not for what we were reading the other day. God. I truly have never read something that went all the way from A to Z and then double A again. The same thing. Over and over. Oh my gosh. How bad did my voice sound that day, Paige?
No, Melissa, when they public defenders get assigned by a judge, which is what goes on here in Indiana, all expenses have to be approved through the judge, period. Everything. They go and submit it for pre-approval. I think I dropped, I'm trying to remember if it was in the My Community page link. You guys can help me remember. Maybe I dropped it in a show link. I can drop it in community page of what Indiana trial law is and about public defenders having to request for funding. So they went to find off attorneys who would agree to be their public defenders. Yes, but, you know, they had to also find people who would have experience dealing with murder trials, right? And they had a lot of people who were not stepping up to do it. But in a trial, they have to get it approved by the judge. I know, Lynn. Yeah. I wanted the same thing. Pro bono.
We question.
And that's not
that
for
too.
Me telling them to be pro bono. They were saying they wanted to be pro bono.
Exactly.
Yeah, the defense just has to prove reasonable doubt. They don't have to prove that the Odinist did it. And if they believe they did it, they still have the right to go interview the holders and see what they can. Man, they're writing lots, aren't they?
Yeah.
Trying to read all these good comments.
You always have a lot of good people in chat.
We
both
do.
Sides,
we
you
do.
Know, both sides. Every, you
absolutely.
Know, and
we don't hate Peter.
No, no, no.
It's okay, Peter. We don't hate you.
No, we do not.
I mean, we'll all know, right? Hopefully.
Oh,
we'll
God.
Get the trial on. Hello, Faye.
Hey, Faye.
Oh, I got you, Melissa.
Yeah.
I got you.
In my opinion, I don't think the defense has created enough doubt because I believe myself that there is a lot of evidence against Richard Allen. We don't have the evidence yet, but I think it is there. That's my opinion.
For the things we have seen, you know, that have been allowed to be public, I agree with you. But I do think there's obviously quite a bit that we have not seen.
I mean, we shouldn't.
I mean,
that's the thing, right? We're not supposed to know till trial. And then
no.
We wouldn't know till after trial. And we know no matter what happens, you know, there's going to be all kinds of shit that goes on after this trial.
Oh, of course.
You know, and I think that Judge Gall, even if she finds in contempt and she decides to fine them or whatever she does, which she has to do, again, anybody joining us late, she has to do that basically the week before trial because she only has 30 days to respond to the memorandums that the defense and prosecution submitted in the evidence that they presented on the leaks. But I do believe these leaks were purposeful based on everything. I believe what McLeland's saying about that. I think Allen is guilty. I just think state has a lot more evidence, but no DNA link. K.
can say Logan, Klein involved, Elvis Fields confess, so there will be a doubt. I think there is, unless there is a lot of evidence, like, so let's say, so I did a little clip video that shows Doug Carter saying that there is DNA. I have a short out there of it early on. And we don't know what kind of DNA that means. He would not answer the question if the DNA was on the girls, right? On the bodies. But he said there is DNA. So let me go there with you, Peter. If there's no DNA, because we don't know.
They also did say that, you know, when they were asked if they had DNA of the killer, they wouldn't specify either. They just said we have DNA.
Right.
Correct.
So let's all though go. We're going to go with Peter here, and let's say there is no DNA whatsoever at the scene. Peter, if they found DNA in his car of the blood of the girls, the case is over.
Yes.
That's my one scenario, that if I heard that they did find DNA in the trunk.
Yeah. And
or on the floorboard of the car, which was on the passenger side, not the driver's side, on the floor.
Or on the seatbelt. It could even be something as simple as what they found possibly isn't DNA or blood or anything like that. It's a hair or a fiber maybe from the clothing the girls were wearing in his car, on his clothing, that kind of thing too. Like maybe it's not blood, DNA, that kind of situation. But it could be something else.
Well, we all know from everybody, you know, if you watch a lot of true crime and you're into true crime, which I'm assuming that's why you're here. So hit that like button and subscribe. But
I'm so proud of you. Yay.
I finally remember to do that.
Girl.
Yes. But if you know, lots of times that when they turn around, if they had any DNA, if the person isn't in CODIS, then they have no idea who that person is until they can get the DNA. So if they started that link, they would have had to wait till they did some genealogy DNA.
That's the thing. People fail to realize how long things take.
Exactly.
Different certain pieces of DNA, evidence, different types of
technology. Well, forensic evidence alone. Look how long it takes Keegan Klein.
And it depends on what they are using to test it.
Right.
And how many times
takes a long time, because it takes long forensically for them to go through it. And the DNA portion. So let's say this. And I was watching a case about this recently where they had hair, but the hair had no follicle. Well, there still is a procedure to get DNA from that hair.
Exactly.
But that procedure takes longer than just a regular, hair with a follicle.
Yeah, that's banding, that's different.
The case of the West Memphis 3, you know, the same with that hair. A lot of people do say that it's connected to Terry Hobbs. But again, if you research, that again didn't have a follicle, it didn't have a root, whatever you call it. And the testing was like very low percentage of being linked to him, that kind of thing. But there are things available to be able to retest stuff like that in that case, which is what they are trying to push for as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can't also get past the I can't get past the confessions either.
No.
I mean, I would think the last person that he would confess to would be his wife. And that the reaction of that he finally, you know, he tells his wife a couple of times in that one call. And she hangs up.
Mom.
I love how they say the call abruptly ends. That's called to hang up.
Exactly. And his mother, you know. Those are the last people you would want.
Your mom.
those are the last people you would want to tell and hurt. You'd tell one of your buddies or this or that, but not your mom and your wife, in my opinion. That's my opinion, but I just have a hard time getting past that also.
So what is everybody's thoughts, guys? Are you, and let's ask, I'll ask Paige, I'll ask you first and we'll go around and then we'll see, we'll let the audience reply, right? Or
yeah, give a thumbs up or a thumbs down.
Justice warriors here. Do you believe that they should be in contempt? Thumbs up in the chat. And Ms. Paige, what do you think from what you've read from that piece?
Yeah. I mean, I'm sorry, but I do. I think they have not done their job. I think it's unprofessional. I think so many words I actually probably shouldn't say. And I just can't understand. I can't understand how anybody looking at all of this who does know about Abby and Libby's case and the facts from the documents we've had from law enforcement in the beginning, the things we've learned before any of this ever came into play and before Richard Allen was ever arrested. I just can't understand how those people can then look at what the defense has done, what they've produced, and say, yep, we believe them.
Peter, I'm not from Wales. Paige is from Wales. Peter was asking, what part of Wales? That's up to you, Miss Paige, if you want to share that.
Yeah, I don't mind. I'm from South Wales. Nice to know we have a fellow Welsh person.
Peter's from North.
Oh.
So. Yeah, I absolutely myself, I believe they need to be held in contempt. I'm sorry what they did, what mm-hmm. they were part of, you know, how they've changed their story from him being a thief to now being, you know, assisting the defense. Too many things have been done. They need to be held in contempt of some type. Are they going to be thrown off the case? No, they're not going to be thrown off the case.
No.
They couldn't even bring back the previous attorneys that stepped in for a period of time because they've already gone out and spoke publicly in regards to the case. So they'd have to bring a whole new
bunch of attorneys. Well, and that Hennessy out there talking like he knows more is bullshit. I mean, give me a break.
Yeah. It's ridiculous. But I think on a monetary level or something, or potentially have their licenses reviewed. Yeah, I definitely think something like that's going to happen. Sure. I don't know. What does Chad think?
Yeah, and honestly, can I just say something else? Like, just reading the Frank's memorandum as well, the first one they put out, even though they're all the same. Anyway, if you've read that more than once, and again, you know this case, you know about Abby and Libby, you will recognize inconsistencies, things you know definitely aren't true. You know, they even have points where they mix the girls' names up. And we know that obviously because we know facts. They say certain things about their clothing, which we've also addressed as incorrect, according to...
Yes.
Family member statements, but also news reports, the report of when they were missing and what was stated as what they were wearing, etc. Right. And that's just a couple of things that were wrong. So,
and I have some shorts, or we also have videos that we address the actual lies that we know that are based on the probable cause affidavit,
right?
Of what we know that was found where we correct that we know.
My point with that is, how can we also trust that they also know enough about this case and about Abby and Libby and about what happened? Because I don't have trust from just reading that document. They seem unprepared all the time. And yeah, I don't have any trust that they can do this correctly. They can't defend Richard Allen in the way he needs to be.
No.
So
I don't even see, and we've talked about this, I just don't even at this point see how you'd be able to get a jury, a good jury pool. I know they're sending out the, you know, questionnaires and doing all that now, but man, it's going to be hard. I mean, heck, we've said it before. I mean, Paige is, you know, here. What, she's from Wales.
Because we are deep in it. That's because we are deep in it, though. But there's a lot of people who they don't have any interest in true crime. They don't watch anything in true crime. And you can name a case to somebody and be like, oh, did you hear blah, blah, blah? And they're like, what? I've never heard about. And some people may have heard of Delphi, but they may not. They're not deep in the woods.
But with all due respect, you can't be standing out here then saying you know something if you don't as well. You know, like, you should be looking for yourself. If someone is telling you something is correct, or, you know, the defense document comes out and you're like, okay, well, this must be true. Just please research things for yourself.
Well, or you know, demand better. Right. If you're watching somebody, don't just believe the diarrhea that comes out of their mouth.
Show me good Lord.
Yeah. Well, you said that this person said this about, you know, the Odinism thing. Can you please show me where you got that information from? Because you didn't put it in this video. You know?
Yep. No, we.
And then to later learn, like we said, if you haven't watched it from the beginning, go back. We later learned that they've never talked to the professor yet. The professor himself came forward. Exactly. He has not been talked to the defense. They are mischaracterizing what he said. These are his words.
That's not
what he was saying.
Yep.
And they're saying it. And you know what? And if I didn't check people's word, here's the problem. YouTube is not like... Well, I hate news sucks too anymore. But anyway, YouTube is not like the news.
I don't watch the news.
I'm trying to not get political. But the news is supposed to tell you, you know, hey, this filing happened, this happened, this is what it said, this is what it said. And you know, you've got to listen to all that and stuff in there. So if you know, if you heard the defense is like, oh my God, this professor from Purdue came up and said this was definitely you know, this type of scene, and it was definitely ritualistic, and it was definitely white supremacy Odinists who live in Rushville and Delphi and blah, 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 blah. And you're like, holy shit, that's a big deal. Oh, wait a minute. You forgot to mention you've never talked to the professor. Okay. Well, that's a thing. Wait a minute. The crime scene photos that you leaked were altered to look more like what you said. Oh, wait a minute. Such manipulation. I mean, I understand you want somebody who's going to defend you, but doesn't every attorney, it's in writing in trial standards and their oath of office of what they're supposed to do, the character they're supposed to have. You're under a legal order to a protective and gag order on crime scene stuff. And you leaked it, and you're telling people to go to the news, and you went to Dateline. How can somebody defend that?
Exactly.
I try not to get on my soapbox, but I can't help it.
Well, it's hard not to, though, JSD. I mean, you know, again, we talk a lot. You know, the three of us have been together for years now, and I mean, all three of us, I mean, obviously this is, you know, Justice Served Daily. This is JSD's channel. She allows, you know, Paige and I to be a part of this channel. And we love being a part of this channel because all three of us are, I think, pretty much same-minded as far as, you know, we want to see proof. The three of us in regards to anything that we're dealing with. We deal with other cases other than just this case. We are in the process of researching other cases.
Have we heard, you know, other things to do with this case or other case that is a rumor or something like that, you know, and we've looked into it? Yes. But have we found anything on that per se? No. So that's why we don't talk about it, you know. So if we can't find anything to show that as proof as to what the theory is, then we're not going to talk about it because it's just a theory.
Again, occasionally, yes, we will invoke and say in our opinion, you know.
Yeah, but there will always be a factual basis for that opinion.
Correct. We do not just go around spewing out stuff to you guys. You know, honestly, JSD would never have started this channel if she wasn't about facts. Just, we know her very well. It would not have happened. Well, let's be honest,
she wouldn't have if you didn't force her to.
Well, I didn't force her to. I didn't force her to. But
we all know the story.
But they appreciate it, and I know there's a lot out there. I mean, I know, you know, Faye being out there and stuff like that, Lynn, stuff like that. They've been in Discords where I was, and I was trying to share information and stuff. You know, I didn't have a channel back then, and I was like, man, there's some shit here that people aren't covering that really needs to be covered. And I really thought that there was more to the CSAM. I really thought that there was more to the Yellow app and the announcement about that was quick and gone. And I researched those and found out a lot of shit and found out how they can be used, how they are being used by pedophiles in other countries before it was brought here. The weirdness about it, how it, you know, they can locate your kids and all that kind of stuff about it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then that's when I was like, you know what? I can't, you know, I share it. I'm not getting anybody else to cover it. Maybe I should try to do my own channel for I Can Point on that, because kids' cases break my heart. And that's the other thing. I mean, Abby and Libby's case gets a lot of views, but we have a lot of kids that are missing and we have a lot of kids that are murdered. And they're unsolved cases. They're cold cases. And they need attention too. Yeah.
And if you look at the NAMIS website or the DOE Network, you will see, you can search areas, you can search by alphabet, and you will see just the amount of people who are missing.
We're working on another case right now. I'm not going to specifically go into who it is, but how long were the three of us on watching videos, listening
to information? 7 hours.
Yes.
We were on the phone yesterday.
Listening and watching videos and all kinds of stuff together.
Well, I mean, that's the thing, though. That isn't our normal standard practice, though. That's because we were going into a case that's existed for a while, because once
we want the background
stuff, we find it, we find some info,
we do look at different
reports, we get police reports,
we pull from checks, all different sources, right?
We do all kinds of stuff to find it. We don't watch other people's videos to get info, we go and see what somebody is saying here and what somebody's saying there. And
with the family members also, you know, like,
but you know what I mean. What I'm saying is,
well, no, they don't. That's why I'm trying to explain. That's not how we do this stuff.
I apologize. But yes, we were watching all day just because we wanted to. We always want to be familiar with the people that we're covering. You know, we want to learn about them directly. We want to watch news reports in regards to what occurred with the situation. That's what I'm trying to say. And, you know, that's how we deal with pretty much every case, I think, you know.
Also, a family member of this person regularly shares things, you know, on their videos and on their Facebook pages and stuff like that. So we were making sure to look at the family's statements and what they believe and stuff like that.
Exactly. So...
yeah, I think that, you know, we wanted to, you know, make sure that if you're watching and you're not subscribed, please hit that subscribe button, hit that like button. That helps us a lot, that other people get to catch up with the videos and see that. Again, I apologize for StreamYard itself just wouldn't go live every time I clicked it. So we've had that delay that happened there. Lots of everyday posts. I at least have a 1 day post, if sometimes not several day posts. You can imagine.
It's always multiple. What are you talking about?
Yes. Yeah. try to not make it all be Delphi filings, but I think that's going to continue to be the trend till we get closer. I think that if there's going to be any attempt to make a plea deal to Richard Allen,
by the prosecutor to the defense. I think it would happen here in the next couple of weeks. I don't know if Baldwin would let his ego go and do what's best for Richard Allen. I think that they're going to claim they don't have enough time to get everything ready. And I think they may try to do a continuance on their so-called speedy trial that they said that they wanted, even though they claimed it was a strategy from them. But other cases that we're working on, and you know, we follow them from the beginning all the way through the ending of April, the court date for the murder of Oakley Snow is approaching, and that is for Roan Waters and Melissa. Is it Melissa? Now I'm thinking here for a second. For her mother, who she was murdered. She was actually from out of Oklahoma, reported missing. She traveled here to Indianapolis with her mother and her mother's boyfriend and her little brother. And she was 2 at the time. And Oklahoma didn't reach out to Indianapolis. Nobody went to search, even though police had been present out at the house before. Roan Waters was wanted out of Oklahoma for abusing that little girl and abusing the mother. Well, that case is coming up on April 29th in Marion County, so I'll be continuing to follow that. If you don't know about that story, please, there's a couple videos on there. Also, when I speak to the grandmother of Oakley Snow, and when we tried to create awareness about it, unbeknownst to us, to find out that she had already been murdered and her body was found in Morgan County in a drawer in an abandoned home or abandoned house. So, but there's lots of cases that we continue to follow. Valerie Tindall, I did an interview with her mother and her little sister. Jackie was part of that show. I just did that show recently. They did give a plea deal to the person who murdered her. However, there is information and questions that they still have, whether she could have been a victim for a long period of time. And they also are concerned that there could be more victims as well. And so, you know, try to continue to follow through on these cases. You know, we want to try to find it to the ending and make sure that, you know, justice is served for all of these cases all the way to the end. We're just not here to just tell a story. We're here to make sure details are shared and that we can be as supportive as we can for anybody. So if you do have a case that you think we should look into or whatever, please send me an email at justiceservedaily@gmail.com. And we'll take a look at it. You know, we try to fit stuff in between cases, and sometimes cold cases work. We work on 3 or 4 things at a time, and then something happens in Delphi or something other else happens, and we got to move and go back to working on something, and then go back to that case. So that's all I can think of. You guys think of anything else? Ms. Paige, Mama Bear, thank you again for being on. Let me know if you think of something or a farewell statement you'd like to say.
Just want to say that I wish, like, I hope everyone remembers, like, a true crime story is always true for someone. So it's not entertainment. And if you are going to, like, publicly talk about something or someone, just make sure that you do your own research and you don't just base it on what someone else has said or told you. And thank you, as always, for having me here. It's always a pleasure.
Well, thank you, Ms. Paige. I appreciate you being on.
Always.
Thanks. How about you, Mama Bear?
I have to reiterate what Paige said. You know, this is a rough case, I think, for obviously everybody that watches, for the most part, too. We always have to be mindful that, you know, there are 2 young girls who are at the base of this case, and their names are Abby and Libby. And that's what this is about. It's not about us. It's about their families who are left behind to pick up the pieces.
Yeah,
in this particular case. So,
absolutely.
But thank you, Justice, for allowing me to be up with you and Paige as usual. And I'm sorry for having the mic issues for myself, too.
Oh, we had all kinds of stuff. The StreamYard was not working. Thank you, Mama Bear.
Thank you. And thank you, chat.
Yeah, great.
Thank you so much, Miss Paige. So, again, want to thank everybody for being here. I appreciate you guys coming to watch and us to provide you information. If there's questions or details that you have, we have tons of videos that go through the sources, the news, the legal documents, everything that we go through that you can look up. I did see the question about, do you think the families would want a plea deal? You know, I can't answer for them. I'm not sure. I'm not sure. But please know that you look in the community page. I have a post I did that was justice for Abby and Libby. And as we saw in that one video, when all the documents first came out, that it was posted from Kelsey about that she always wanted to not forget about, that it is justice for Abby and Libby, and that she wanted the justice for Abby and Libby symbol to make sure it's talking about those girls and not about anything else. So I have a community post of that. So if you want to share that out on your YouTube or take that image and share it on your Facebook and tag a justice for Abby and Libby, for that trend will be there. And it's not all about Richard Allen. And it's definitely not about the defense attorneys, you know, Baldwin and Rosie. It's about the murder of these two girls and us getting the answers and the truth. And if he's guilty, then he'll be convicted and that people will be held accountable. So expect better from the people who are bringing you news, and make sure, you know, if you're hearing it, where did they get that from? So I want to thank again, Mama Bear and Paige. Thank you, Miss Jinx, for being here and modding. Thank you to CJK for modding. And I appreciate all of you. We will see you again real soon. And thank you for making sure justice is served daily. Goodbye, guys.